Hello again. I'm back for your second reading today. And this reading is going to be on Prince Harry and Meghan. Okay. So, just before I start, you know I can't help myself. I have to have a rant. As an Australian, and more particularly an Irish Australian, my heritage is Irish, and the English occupied Ireland for the last 700 years. So I'm not particularly impressed with the royal family. The royal family, to me, represent colonisation and the repression of the Irish. So not only did they tramp around the world and take over India and the West Indies and vast tracts of Africa and an attempt to run the United States, Australia was founded as a penal colony. So people were sent to Australia as convicts. And when you read the record of what they were sent for, most of them weren't murderers and rapists or things. If you murdered people, you just got hung in England. So it wasn't that. They were sent out mainly for theft and mainly for micro theft. You had women sent out for stealing a handkerchief. You had children sent out and men sent out for things like stealing a horse. Right? And you were sentenced from between 7 years, 14 years and life in the penal colony in Australia. So I am not a fan of the monarchy. I also don't believe, deep in my Irish-Australian heart, that anyone who's just born into a family should be able to rule an entire country. Sorry, don't get it, don't understand it, don't support it. So I'm not particularly enamoured with any of them. This generation seems all right, but that's just the luck of the draw, right? You know, any nutcase could get up and be the next in line for the throne because people are born to rule. So, also, before I leave the rant, growing up in an English colony, which Australia was when I was young, we had a picture of the Queen in every single classroom in Australia. Every morning before school, we had to sing the national anthem, God save our gracious Queen, God save our noble Queen, long may she reign over us, and all this terrible stuff of empire. Even in movie theatres, you were expected to stand while the national anthem was played. I mean, so when young Australians say to me, oh, isn't it nice, there's a new royal baby, oh, and isn't he cute, and isn't she cute, and I go, really, you guys, they don't get it because they didn't have that experience. Australian schools no longer do that sort of rubbish. But there's a generational hiatus around that, and the royals remain very popular. So, of the royals, what changed the royal family, basically, in modern history was Princess Diana, the mother of Harry. Now, for those of you who are familiar with Princess Diana, she did some amazing things, and that included things like supporting campaigns to fund going into countries that had thousands of landmines in all sorts of war conflict zones, because kids go out after a war's over and they still get their legs blown off and stuff because of landmines. And a lot of famous, wealthy, powerful women back causes, and so they should, but often they're not as hard line as something like landmines. It's easier to sort of back cancer research or something. But the other thing she did that I think is her greatest legacy was at the height of the HIV/AIDS hysteria, when people who had HIV were treated by doctors and nurses basically wearing space suits. She looked at the science and said, no, that's not how it's transmitted. And she went in and sat on the beds and held the hands of dying AIDS patients. And because of her, it changed how HIV patients were treated all over the world, at least in the first world. And so more power to her elbow, you know, and I think it was a tragedy. She did die so young. So I have other criticisms of Diana, but basically I think she did an amazing job and she modernized the royal family. And her values, her deeply felt social values, were passed on to her boys. So that's a credit to her, because unlike other wealthy aristocratic women, she actually raised her children. So that set her apart. She was actually there for them, you know, and was a real mum. And she was also a kindy teacher before she married Charles. So she cared about kids. And I think the reason that both Will and Harry are the sane and compassionate individuals they are largely a credit to her. So full marks, Diana. Now, this particular reading is on Harry and his American princess, Meghan Markle. Okay, so I'm going to do a quite elaborate reading, the one I did for Trump and Melania's relationship. So this layout I will describe to you as I go. So give me a moment, because it's quite complex to lay out. All right, so all right. Let me show you how these work. All right, these two cards, which I will turn up first, the relationship as it happened and up until now. So let's see. Very nice. Now, the first card is strength. Excuse me while I have a bit of a cough. Thank you all for your patience. Okay, it's the strength card. So for these two young people, they are both very strong-willed individuals. So neither of them are people who just float through life. They've got strong opinions. They care about things, and they bring that strength to the relationship. So what attracted them to each other was that strength of character. So that's quite a good foundation. Particularly if their relationship now is reflected by this card, which is the beautiful card of the Star and hope and emotional fulfillment. So they're loved up to the max as we speak. All right, so that's very auspicious in the beginning. Okay, now, the next cards are their karmic history and their karmic destiny. So I'm going to read the history first and then move to these other cards and come back to their karmic destiny in a little while. So what is their karmic history? Page of Pentacles. Again, a very strong card. A fresh card in terms of whether you believe in past lives or not, in terms of how this reading unfolds, they are young people who have also been very ethical in past lives, who have been educated in past lives. This card represents deep intellectual knowledge as well. Money and talent represented by the Pentacles. So I think that suggests to me that when they knew each other previously in karmic terms, they were born to wealthy enough families then too, because don't forget, you know, one could have been a chimney sweep in their last life and another somebody else. But this indicates there was money enough to educate them. This card is about education and money and talent. So again, compared with the Trump and Melania reading, you can see already how they're so radically different. Okay, next, Megan's subconscious drives in the relationship or needs, and her conscious drives in the relationship. So let's see what's going on for Megan here. Subconsciously, the card of nostalgia and the past. I think she recognized Harry, actually, from a past life. I think she's quite comfortable with him. In a way, obviously, most people in most relationships are comfortable with each other, but it's not always such an obvious and snug fit. But I think subconsciously she recognized him emotionally. This is a card of the emotions in the past. There's also a castle there, which bears out this thing that even if they had shared lives before and they were a fisherman meeting, you know, someone else or whatever, they did have these quite affluent past lives. But they've learnt from those too, it would seem to me, to have this card. So they are building, if you like. It's about people learning their life lessons and moving on, as opposed to Trump and Melania. Both of them fail to learn their last lessons and therefore are reliving it. So subconsciously she recognised him. Consciously, what was she after? So the Queen of Pentacles, this is a woman with a powerful relationship to money and power. So whether that is Megan herself or her mother or a strong female mentor, I'm not quite sure. But consciously, she needed someone with the strength, because she's strong, to understand she's going to be a powerful player. She is also, although there are a lot of royal protocols and she won't be able to just go and get a job in a soapy anymore or a program, she could use her television skills in another way to earn money, whether she donates that to charity or whatever. The point is, this is an accomplished person, and if you read it as Megan, she will also keep her own money. Okay, so she's not going to be, oh, I'm a princess now and I'll just hope for the best. She's powerful. She's very strong. Okay, for Harry, subconsciously, what was he bringing to the table? The trade-off, or if you like, scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. So in this, he was perhaps less evolved, for want of a better word, than Megan. He was just looking, you know, for someone who could be a partner. But in previous relationships, and he hasn't had, to my knowledge, sort of deep, long-term live-in commitments, he's dallied a bit. And I think this card sort of says that he wasn't ready. He still saw himself as the center of the universe a bit, and they were lucky to go out with him. And I think he's matured from that point. So subconsciously, he was very aware that he was a prince, you know, and that he did have access to money. So slightly less evolved than the fiancé. So consciously, the moon. So the moon is quintessential female energy. This is his mother. This is Princess Diana. So it's not surprising that consciously he was aware enough to know he has a huge debt to his mother, her knowledge, her wisdom. He also has come out recently saying he really had mental health issues after her untimely death. And I think the slight madness that comes with the moon card is represented there. He really desperately needed a healing relationship. So things could have gone very wrong if Harry had sort of just been the young playboy prince and was besotted and wanted to marry someone because they had a nice ass, if he was that shallow still and that unformed, this could have got very ugly. But I think because the other cards are so positive, this means that the positive things that he has learnt emotionally from his mother in life, her values, but her death that was really, really profoundly distressing to him. I think these things are going to be brought together in this relationship. The karmic destiny of the relationship. Oh, lovely. Temperance. Huge respect for each other. That is really important. They are both strong-willed. She's not going, she'll toe the line because there's a lot of restrictions on being a royal, but she will also make her own mark on the royal family, much like Princess Diana did. And temperance, this is lovely, this is integration. Very positive. Now, the next two cards. This is their short-term and longer-term outcomes. I'm thinking with this card, the Three of Wands, overseas, what they share is also a fearlessness about travelling overseas and being world citizens. But this figure is quite accomplished, meaning in their future, because it's about two people, they will be quite accomplished. It won't be without problems, no relationship is, but also the role is very demanding. He's third in line for the throne, so the next is his father, then his older brother, then him. It's one, two, three. He may become king in his lifetime. Who knows? I'd have to do another reading about that, but there is a possibility that that may happen. The next outcome card is the Three of Pentacles. Now, with the Three of Pentacles, which has come up quite a lot in the political readings I do, as I've said before, every card in the tarot has a spectrum of meanings and then layers of interpretation. So this I have read in the context of political readings as a price for everything and everything has its price. Okay, so I'm going to stick by that in the sense of this is not a normal relationship or a normal marriage. It can't be. They've got the eyes of the world on them from this point on. Every waking moment, every fart is recorded. All eyes are on them. But the more positive interpretation of this card is group work, and I think both of them are very capable of changing the social situation, not only in the UK, but more broadly. So if you look closely, these figures, which to a certain extent represent them, the male and female, who are coming to the master craftsman, the mason, on quality. This is about quality, and they're exceptional young people, both of them. I think that quality doesn't mean like Steve Mnuchin's wife, I've got a Versace handbag and a Dolce Vita pair of shoes and something else, label. It's not quality in that way. It's about quality and respect. And one of the things I've grudgingly admired about Harry is because there's a tradition of the second son in the royal family being in the armed forces, he insisted as far as possible he was treated as one of the guys. And the other guys who served with him in Afghanistan and other places have said he did that. So he brings qualities that are unusual in that sense. And Meghan Markle too, she, before she even met Harry, she was off in her car keys doing worthy things in the world. She's not a shallow person. So I think they have tremendous power, these two, in terms of improving the quality of life of other people in their sphere. So I find that quite an engaging and positive reading for them, and I wish them all the best. So, even though I'm not a fan of the Royals, if they're going to be there, at least these two are decent people. So more power to them. Bye now.